Did you know that you can indirectly invest in the Nifty 50 index with just 120 rupees, whereas buying each stock of Nifty 50 would cost you around 1 lakh? Say hello to exchange traded funds or ETFs. I'm Ujjwal and we learn how ETFs work in this elementary video. By the end of this video, you would have understood how exactly an ETF is created and how its performance is tracked. In the last video, we discussed Golu and Gudiya's wedding. Out of hundreds and hundreds of friends, family and acquaintances, they decided to choose a group of 50 people to come to their wedding to represent all their people. We call this group of 50 people an index. So, the wedding is all done now and Golu and Gudiya are going through the photographs to relive the memories. Why is Neeti making a duck face everywhere? And why is she present in every picture? And why is Prakash not present in any? Probably fighting with his girlfriend somewhere. Like in a wedding, the photographs represent what happened at the wedding, or at least they try to mimic the wedding atmosphere. They're a tangible physical proof of the wedding, along with the 4 lakh worth engagement rings that Golu and Gudiya are now paying EMI for. Badhaiyo. So the photos are ETFs or exchange traded funds. They are trying to mimic the index. We did a dedicated video on what an index is featuring frustrated but less poor Golu and Gudiya. Click here to watch the video. ETFs are essentially mutual funds. We'll cover mutual funds in detail in a video later, but essentially it's a fund which buys and holds securities on your behalf. Say you wanted to invest in the Nifty 50 index. To do it yourself, you'd have to buy each constituent of the Nifty 50 index in their respective weight percentages. That will cost you a lot, more than 1 lakh rupees. An ETF will do that for you, purchase these securities by creating a fund and then give you units or shares of that fund, which will be much cheaper for you, around 120 rupees. Obviously, similar units will be given to many other investors like you. Alright, so far this sounds very similar to mutual funds. So what's the difference? ETFs can be bought and sold on an exchange like the NSE, the National Stock Exchange, or the BSE, the Bombay Stock Exchange. So their price changes during the entire trading day, while mutual funds unit prices are determined once daily. Another big difference between ETFs and mutual funds is how the general public interacts with the sponsor or the asset management company, the AMC. In the case of ETFs, unlike mutual funds, units are not sold directly to retail investors for cash. There is a group of large institutions called authorized participants or APs who deal with the AMCs. They sit between the AMC and the retail user. Let's understand how ETF creation and redemption happens. To create new ETF units, APs deposit a combination of underlying indexes, stocks and cash with the AMC, and in return, they get a big block of ETF units from the AMCs. These are called creation units. They then break these creation units into individual units and then sell on the exchange, which retail investors like you or I purchase. Similarly, when these APs send redemption instructions to the AMCs, they submit a block of ETF units to the AMC, and in return, they get the underlying stocks from the AMC. So basically, APs regulate how many units of the ETF are outstanding in the market at any given time. This structure allows for APs to take advantage of mismatch between the value of an ETF unit and its underlying stocks. If underlying stocks have less combined value than the value of the ETF unit, APs will deposit the stocks with the AMC and get ETF units in return, which they'll sell on the exchange for a profit. And if underlying stocks have more value than the ETF unit, they'll buy the ETF units from the market and send those units to the AMC and get stocks in return. Again, profit for the AP. This buying and selling activity by the AMCs ensures that the value of a unit of the ETF, also called net asset value or NAV, is more or less in line with the value of the underlying securities. So many things at work in the background to allow you to trade in ETFs, isn't it? But at least you know now how the entire thing works. Alright, so why should you invest in ETFs? Let's understand two concepts first. Active investing and passive investing. The goal of active investment is to beat the average return of the stock market. That is, to achieve a return higher than what a broad market index like Nifty 50 would achieve. Investors would actively select stocks on the basis of fundamentals and invest in stocks which they think will outperform, and reject stocks which they believe will not perform that well. After stock selection, it requires constant monitoring and expertise to be able to switch these stocks as the fundamentals change. This is not gambling, but a dedicated and systematic approach to monitoring portfolio performance and making changes whenever necessary. The objective is to be right more times than wrong. Passive investing is a laid-back approach to investing. The objective is not to beat the market or index returns, but to replicate it. The idea behind passive investing is that in the long term, the market as a whole will provide sufficient return and the investor is better off investing in the entire market than manually selecting and monitoring and editing their portfolio. This limits the amount of buying and selling of securities and is more of a buy and hold mentality. An ETF is a tool for passive investing since it tries to mimic the return of an index. Two metrics that one should actively look at for ETFs are tracking error and expense ratio. Let's head to ticker tape and look at Nippon India Nifty 50 B's ETF, which tracks the Nifty 50 index. Tracking error that you see here is an indicator of how far away from index returns the ETF's returns are. In technical terms, it's the standard deviation of difference between the index and the ETF's returns. The lower this number, the better the ETF is at replicating the index returns. The next metric to look at is the expense ratio. This represents the administrative and running costs of the fund. Basically, you pay for that as an investor. ETFs are more efficient than mutual funds, hence have in general lower expense ratio due to them being listed on the exchange. So, if investor A sells an ETF and investor B buys it, the fund is not involved and doesn't have to do anything in the process. Also, since ETF creation and redemption is handled by APs, the fund doesn't have to buy or sell underlying stocks every time a retail investor purchases or sells an ETF. Another metric on this page that's interesting is the real-time NAV, which represents the real-time value of the underlying securities in the ETFs. We discussed earlier that APs create or redeem ETF units when the difference between the two values increases. The closer real-time NAV is to the actual NAV of the ETF, the better it represents the value of the securities it holds. Active versus passive is a topic that attracts very heated discussion amongst investors, whether active investing is better or one should just invest passively. Practically, one should follow a combination of the two strategies. Say 50% invested passively in an ETF or an index tracking mutual fund, with the rest being managed actively. Of course, this depends on the expertise level and the time available to actively be on top of one's active portfolio. Or in case you have outsourced active management to a professional investor who does it on your behalf, one has to also be mindful of the performance of the investment manager and the fee charged. So how about you? Which style do you prefer of the two? Active or passive investing? And in what percentages? Let us know in the comments below. And for more such simple explanations, subscribe to our channel. Keep it simple.